Our next session is extremely exciting. We're going to learn how can Google Glass remotely integrate with microfluidic biosensors and actuators. And our presenter is Dr. Zhang, who holds Ph.D. in biomedical engineering from Georgia Institute of Technology. He is currently an instructor of medicine and associate bioengineer at Brigham and Women's Hospital in Harvard Medical School and affiliated with Harvard MIT Division of Health Sciences and Technology and Wyss Institute for Biologically Inspired Engineering at Harvard University. Dr. Zhang's research is focused on innovating biomaterials and engineering technologies to build and characterize biomimetic tissues, including organs on chips, 3D bioprinting, medical devices, biomedical imaging, and biosensing. At leisure, he enjoys bird and nature watching, traveling, and photography. More information can be found on his website, shrikezhang.wibbly.com, and we'll see it in his presentation. It's a pleasure to have you with us today, and please come forward. I'd like to also share with you the news that you are the recipient of the FHTI 2016 project recognition. And here is your recognition.
Thank you.
It's innovation and for amazing connection between Google Glass and actuators and biosensors.
Today I'm going to talk about actually one of the most interesting projects that we have done in the lab, which is to connect Google Glass with our organs on chip platforms. So everything starts with the drug development process. So it is a very lengthy and expensive process. It generally takes hundreds of millions or even billions of dollars for the development of a single drug formulation out of tens, hundreds of candidates over a period of 10 to 15 years in order to pass the strict FDA approval process. And let's take a look at the big pharmas in the Cambridge area. These three pharma companies, including Novartis, Pfizer, and Takeda, they together spent over $25 billion per year just to develop new drug formulations. So how is the productivity of the pharma industry given this huge amount of capital invested? If we look at this graph, the cost for the development of a single drug formulation in the past 20 years has almost tripled. But if you look at the number of the drugs approved, it hasn't really changed, meaning that this productivity of pharma industry has really gone down instead of gone up. So the major cause of failure of the drugs during the human phase trials are largely attributed to the efficacy and safety issues. And these efficacy and safety issues have pretty much prevented them from entering into the market. On the other hand, many of the drug formulations that had already entered into the market were later on recalled by the FDA due to the toxicities that were not discovered during the developmental process. For example, the most renowned example being this Vioxx, which almost cost Merck to pay $4.5 billion. Right, and then if we look at the efficacy and safety results from the preclinical models and the human body, they don't really match. Right, so this pretty much is due to the inability of these current models to predict human responses, whether they're standard static planar cell cultures or animal models. So to this end, the organs on chips have been recently developed in the past few years as in vitro human organ models mimicking the important aspects of the in vivo counterparts. And then when they're made of human cells in the right composition, structure, and architecture, they can be used to probe and accurately predict human responses towards, let's say, pharmaceutical compounds, chemicals, or even biological species. And then these individual organ knots can be further interconnected together in the fashion that integral system also mimic the physiology or the blood connection, but that's a connection in the human body, further enabling the investigations of the pharmacodynamics and pharmacokinetics of the drugs as well. And most importantly, when in combination with patient-derived cells, these personalized organ models can be used for screening drugs that are used for or effective for the specific patients, which cannot be done with any existing models. On the other hand, when we already have the organ chip models, right? So another important thing is to be able to also monitor how these organ models, organoids, are going to respond to the drug molecules infused into the system. For example, we have to monitor the biochemical parameters, such as the secretion level of the biomarkers in response to the drug insult. And we have to monitor the physical environment, such as oxygen, pH, temperature levels, to be able to make sure that the organoids are experiencing the right environment, and then how and monitor how they respond to the drug molecules. And then we can, we should also monitor the optic, the morphologies or the beating, let's say, of the cardiomyocytes of the heart cells, and then see how they actually respond to the infused pharmaceutical compounds. And then, in our sense, this different sensors that we incorporate with the organ chip system is as important as the biological functions of the organoids themselves, because we have to really be able to continuously monitor the responses over extended periods of time in order to understand the drug effects. So I'm going to mainly focus on the two types of sensors that's shown here, the physical sensors and the optical sensors. So we first developed the miniaturized microscope, which can be directly fitted at the bottom of the bioreactors hosting these miniaturized human organs. So basically, we developed this cost-effective microscope from the webcam, which is basically under $10. What we did is that we actually took the imaging sensor from the webcam and then flipped the lens in order to achieve the magnifying mechanism rather than the demagnifying mechanism initially for the webcam. And then we made the microscope out of this. And then by modulating the distance between the objective and the sensor, we were able to achieve different magnifications. For example, we can see these cells cultured in the bioreactor at different magnifications. And then, of course, we can monitor how the cells are migrating or how the cardiac cells are beating inside the bioreactors in real time over extended periods of time, and we can analyze how the beating rate of the cardiomyocytes. So if we look at these cells actually beating over there. And then we have also developed a little, this little chip being able to monitor the temperature and pH values of the entire system. And then we hosted this in a microfluidic device to be able to integrate it with the organs on chip platform. And then we, when we integrate this with an organ chip platform, we did, we were able to monitor temperature pH values over, this is up to 5 days tested in a complete non-invasive manner and continuous manner. And then by ensuring the values of temperature and pH, we're able to maintain the viability of this, of our organoids inside the bioreactor over this time. So but then one issue is that this is how we currently measure our data, right? So everything is based on desktop computer, right? So I have to sit right beside these computer screens to be able to monitor the data and then be able to also control how the this device is working, which is not very convenient in most cases. And then in recent years, the development of smartphone has really like being able to transmit this data to the smartphone, and then you can pretty much take it anywhere in a mobile manner. But then one issue here is that you have to have your hands to hold the devices to be able to monitor the data. Right, so naturally people are thinking about wearable devices, right? You can put your camera right in front of your head, and then the microphone, the cell phones right beside your head, your ears, and then be able to do all these things in a hands-free manner, right? So the only issue is that they're a little heavy, but who cares as long as they work? But apparently Google thinks differently, right? So this is why they actually invented this Google Glass, which is the wearable device that contains all these different functions in the single glass. For example, here we had a camera in the front which can take pictures and videos directly from the Google Glass. We have a microphone here that you can directly talk to it, and then be able to communicate with other people or actually communicate with the glass itself. And then we have a screen here at the front, which is basically projecting the images or videos from this prism here and be able to for people to observe with their eyes. And then they have these computer built-in on the side and the touchpad to be able to control the operations inside Google Glass. And then using Google Glass, you can pretty much operate in a hand, like semi-hand-free manner or completely hand-free manner. Right? So you can either swipe this pad on the side or just say commands directly to the glass. For example, OK Glass, or you can even say take a picture, then it's going to take a picture. So it's a very interesting piece of device. Then you can actually do a lot of different things in on Glass in a completely hands-free manner. Right, so then this Google Glass has been used for, I guess, daily life for people. But then we thought that if we can actually use the glass and then connect the glass with our sensors, then you don't have to sit in front of the computer. You just move around with the glass and then potentially observe all these things on the glass and also be able to control the devices using the glass, right? So that's why we actually set up this project to be able to develop all these programs and hardwares to be able to communicate the sensors with the glass. So I'm not going to go into very details here, but then the take-home message here is that we can actually collect the sensor data with this driver, this BeagleBone blackboard here, and then transmit data wirelessly to a Google App Engine, which is a cloud-based data storage. And then we can use Google Glass to constantly inquire the data stored on the Google App Engine and then be able to retrieve the data in a real-time manner. And then on the other hand, it's not only one way. We can, if we use a touchpad or actually talk to the glass, we can actually also send commands wirelessly to this driver here, which can also drive the valves, electro valves, and then realize the control of the microfluidic devices that we actually run. So I'm just going to give some examples of the interface here that we developed. So basically, what you do is that you tap on the side, and then it's going to give you a bunch of live cards that we call. And then you swipe it, and then you can actually, if you tap, it's going to go into the live card that you want. And then we can achieve different functions here. For example, we can view pH values of the sensors. We can view temperature from the sensors. We can even transmit videos. For example, the beating of the cardiac cells directly onto the glass. And then not only that, we can also directly analyze the beating from these cardiomyocytes from the Google Glass itself. And then we can also achieve the reverse control, which is to be able to drive the electro valves from the Google Glass by actually talking to the glass, communicating with the glass. So one example here we showed is that we built a heart-on-chip device, which contained beating cardiac cells in the microfluidic devices. And then we did a series of different experiments here. In the first experiment, we were actually removing the heart-on-chip device out of the incubator. So it is well known that when the cardiomyocytes are undergo temperature change, the beating rate of the cardiomyocytes also changes. Right. So when we took the device out, we did show a drop in temperature, and then over time, and then when we put it back, the temperature raised. So everything here is shown was observed on the glass. We just took a screenshot of the glass and then put it here. And then as we saw the temperature drop, we also did see the change in the beating of the cardiomyocytes, the video and the analysis of beating rate. And then when we took the cardiomyocytes out for 10 minutes, the beating rate significantly dropped. If it's normal, then it should be very regular as we saw before. And then after 30 minutes at room temperature, the cardiomyocytes completely stopped beating. And then we could recapitulate all this on the glass. And then we did infuse a drug molecule into the device. So for example, at 37 degrees, the cardiomyocytes are supposed to beat very regularly, but then we'll infuse this anti-cancer drug, doxorubicin, and then we did see like the formation of the arrhythmia by the cardiomyocytes, which induced the cardiomyocytes to beat irregularly. And then everything here was recapitulated on the glass. So here shows the how we can actually fetch sensor data from and display them on the glass. And then next we further showed that we can actually also control the devices using glass. So for example, here we're toggling these different electrical valves and drive the fluid flow into the device. And then we did show that when we change these valves, when we turn on or off these valves, we can actually drive the fluid flow into this chip. This is an image taken by the microscope, actually direct fitted on the bottom of the device. And we did show that we can conveniently control all these microfluidic devices or actuators and then be able to control the fluidics inside the chips using this Google Glass interface. Right, so what can we do with this? So what we did is that we can actually use this as a remote control to actually infuse drug molecules into the devices and be able to also simultaneously observe their effects to the organoids that we have here. For example, we had this liver organoid inside the bioreactor. Initially, it showed very regular, tight morphology observed by the miniature microscope fitted at the bottom. And then we could actually actuate this valve and then infuse this drug, acetaminophen, which is the liver toxic drug, into the main chamber hosting the liver organoids. And then what we saw that is that when we infused the acetaminophen into the device, after 12 hours of the incubation with the drug and the organoid, we did see death of the liver organoid as demonstrated by the swelling of the cells inside this organoid. So it pretty much shows that not only we can control the valves, the devices to be able to achieve on-demand infusion of the drugs, but we can also use the device at the bottom of the miniature microscope at the bottom of the organ chip device to be able to also display the sensing data on the Google Glass. And then this is just a control experiment to show our results. So basically, we did show that using off-chip assay, the cells were affected with their viability, and then the damage biomarker release was increased as we infused drugs into the device. All right, so to conclude, so we have successfully integrated the Google Glass with different sensor data obtained from the sensors integrated with organ chip devices that we have created. And then it's not only one way monitoring, it's also it can also give active command to these microfluidic devices to be able to control the infusion of drug molecules into this device as we wish. Right. So now I want to acknowledge all the people in the lab. It's a huge lab. So we have now, this is actually taken last year where we had about maybe 50 people. Now we have over 100 people in the lab now. So here I can't take any questions if there's any. Thank you very much.
I noticed you had the NIH on there, and I was just listening to a talk given by the NIH, and they brought up the same subject. Is this in close relationship to them, a collaboration with them?
No, actually, this particular one was DOD. Yeah, we have some elements because if you're making the organs, then it's pretty much NIH. But then if you're more moving towards the sensor side, it's more towards the defense. Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.